Bonjour, Nicole, Madame Brodeur, distinguished colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very, very touched and honored to be here today. It was my privilege to know Jean-Paul. It's marvelous that we're able to gather here and to think about and remember his work. It requires, of course, a bit of imagination and reimagination. And he always walked a bit in front of us, and that was his style, plucking words as he walked, smiling a bit, and then perhaps resting his feet. he once pointed out the window of his office and said, "You see the tower there? I used to think of Leibniz." And I thought to myself, yes, probably Flaubert, Balzac, Baudelaire, and maybe Mordecai Richler as well. I recall also thinking about Jean-Paul's mastery of matters. I asked him once, "Do you think community policing has made a change in the policing style in North America?" And he said, "I will answer in the manner that Mao answered concerning the French Revolution. It is too soon to know." So the world in which Jean-Paul walked and lived was multifaceted and very rich in contextualized detail. He was a bilingual sociologist, criminologist of polymorphous dexterity. I thought I would throw that in as a way of waking people up. As Carlo Marcelli noted in his brief obituary, Jean-Paul was an early and frequent Francophone participant in ASC, where I think I met him some years ago. He could run a commission, work a room, reform penal policy, do a little dance, summarize 95 papers at a conference, and entertain us with a grand, and often summarized better than the presenters had done themselves, and end with a grand dinner. So we will again be replicating the genius of his mastery of social life. And he had a great élan vital, a great patience, and a great kindness, which was unusual in academic life. And I think that he suffered on both sides of the Atlantic for both for these wonderful qualities. His interest in part was in the anomalies of postmodern democratic societies. What are the contradictions that arise repeatedly that challenge us, should challenge us? The contradiction of the necessity of violence and yet its need for regulation. The policing as an essentially authoritarian, anti-democratic force in many ways, but adapted to what we would call democracy. His gift was certainly to communicate in many languages, unbeknownst to me before, including Oriental languages, German, French, English, and American, which was also he could carry out very easily. And as this room demonstrates, had a marvelous capacity to engender an intellectual fellowship and excitement in many students throughout North America, Germany, France, and perhaps elsewhere. As I've already mentioned, think of him as, and I use this advisedly, that he was an observer who noted things out of place, deviations from the rule or norm, and somewhat as Tony Dobish has shown, and as others have shown, the sensitivity to those contradictions was what made his ideas powerful. He was never in any way a conventional sociologist, criminologist, or philosopher. And it seemed to me that his facility was to be an anomalies processor, or as he calls them, the antimonies processor, these contradictions that troubled him. I think it's inspired him to think of policing as an ensemble, as a puzzle, as an assemblage, as a web, all metaphors that suggest tension, ambiguity, contradiction, inabilities, and a certain kind of fragility, which I think is a marvelous way in which one could think about it. But I stray from the topic of the impact of his work in the English-speaking world. In his modest, shortened 57-page vita, probably an understatement of his accomplishments. One finds, in English, 5 books, 39 chapters, over 100 articles, abundant essay reviews, and some 9 significant reports, commissions, and commentaries. I begin my brief presentation with your patience in the manner of Jean-Paul. My paper has 3 parts. First, I will discuss and comment on the high-low policing paper, which is connected to me going back to police work, going back to work that I did in England in the early 70s. Then I would like to assess the prescience or the farsightedness of the paper with respect to contemporaneous developments, with reference to computer science, intelligence, and so on. And thirdly, I might talk a bit, just very briefly, about the theory of policing, which colleagues have already somewhat worked well and raised important questions prior to my talk. So to walk along with the high policing paper, he drew on his experience in 1979-81 as chief consultant to the Keeble Inquiry and proposed a new paradigm of policing. Remember that at this time, or for those of you who weren't even alive then, this was a time, some of us were alive but not alive in the same way until we met this paper. This paper said, came to the point of dissent, Vietnam challenges, the civil rights, the death of Bobby Kennedy, the death of Martin Luther King, the death of the hope of a whole generation of people, and began to unfold the nature of how policing was, it's systematically gathering information, surveilling, monitoring everyday life in a ways that no one had understood. The police syllabus at the time would be very modest. There were very little knowledge of anything in French, even by scholars in North America or Francophones. There was very little other than a handful of papers and books written by a number of people, including myself, and that the work of colonial policing and the remnants and residues of that had not been discussed. So in this context, Bittner's work was cited but not understood, and I dare say it's still not very well understood. I think John Paul is among the few who did understand it very well, but it's generally not understood, misquoted, misused, misunderstood systematically. In short, this paper was a turning point in thinking about policing in a very subtle and interesting way. It begins, and I beg the pardon of those who know this inside and out, but it begins with 2 assertions. Not all policing could all be political, nor could no policing be political, and goes on to say that this active-passive distinction is not helpful, that all policing is about political ordering. And I'll come back to that question. And that there's complicity. What is the secret? The politicians know it. The courts know it. The cops know it. Certainly the higher federal agencies and the centralized know it. It's going on. So where is the secret? The secret, and the illusion is sustained by many of my less competent colleagues, that there's always this front stage version, which is the real thing, the Bobby on the beat with the hat and so on, or the municipal police officer. And there, this leads to the notion that occasionally you have the rotten apple, and occasionally you have the deviant, and occasionally you have the odd scandal that embarrasses everyone, but these are really odd. And if you could really just clamp down more laws, more reforms, look at the same thing goes on in the corrections, goes on in the field generally, denies the illusion that this is in fact a systematic and continuing pattern. Now, one of the ironies that I think that Jean-Paul brought out beautifully was, how is it that the state that protects us is now a victim of these terrible criminals who are committing all kinds of crime? Well, therefore, in order to enforce such dissidents and is to resort to informants and so on, intelligence gathering, and uses the history of French policing, to which I defer to my colleagues previously, to illustrate the fact that policing has various images, various formats, that the Peel version of policing is one that's become seen as the character of it, but in misleading terms. And that policing essentially is a systematic attempt to preserve the distribution of power in a given society. He then discusses the four features of it with which you're mostly, I'm sure, quite aware. And he ends by saying that all policing has features of high policing and is relentless and implies systematic continuity. The point, amongst many, is that policing always functions with a political face and denies it publicly. So the front stage, backstage, if I may, and that these notions were developed through a series of papers, some written with those of you in the audience, Trotsky and Reform, Cops and Spooks, High Policing Post 9/11, and so on, and the work on accountability. Now, in the policing web, which, let us say, as Mao said about the French Revolution, is too soon to know. I suspect that the people in this room will know the importance and impact of this masterful work in due course. And it would be my pleasure to see it. But high policing is the centerpiece around which other policing's activities revolve. So that, in Chapter 7, it's an odd placement in my judgment, but nevertheless, the core point here is that since high policing is the umbrella that covers that the gap between what should be done and what could be done, therefore, it is the defining feature of that within this, the web, that is the systematic differential, right? How it is that violence, secrecy, surveillance, and so on functions in each of these contexts is how the web holds together and how it's differentiated. It's a brilliant point. It's a brilliant point. He makes some elimination of his concern. He talks then about nine features of high policing, a somewhat elaboration of the original one. And he makes the distinction, which he and I had discussed, between Chapman's notion about governance and high policing as a kind of equivalent to government, that it is really quite different in its form that it's taken in North America. Then talks about the way in which it operates, and then includes, finally, this masterful diagram on page 252, in which he attempts to contrast diagrammatically, high and low policing, and it's a masterful integration. So, some reflections. There are four points in the Anglophone world. It's kind of interesting. It's a little bit like Molière. I discovered after I was asked to do this that I'd been speaking Anglophone all my life and didn't know it. It's such a wonderful revelation. Something like knowing that you speak prose. But in any case, there are at least four major issues that the impact of this paper can be identified in the community. Of course, I should have said earlier that Jean-Paul integrated and brought together networks of people, language cultures, different territorial cultures, political governance, political perspectives in his patience and his wisdom. And so the way in which many of the influences are not easily identified by in terms of Anglophone or not. I think he raised issues about human rights, about comparative historical work sensitive to high policing. He certainly broadened the notion of policing more than noodle policing, as was suggested earlier. It's a pun, of course. If Clifford were here, he would not be happy to hear that. There's more than one noodle is being baked. Okay, high policing also mentions and brings out some of the importance of the high policing in all democratic societies. And in fact, as my colleagues have suggested in my poor understanding of their eloquent French, that the notion that it is simply a kind of Anglophone and Francophone difference historically is perhaps needs further discussion. I would say finally about this first one, that the illusion of visible public policing allowed the umbrella of secrecy to be sustained over the rest of it. Second, what about the ideas with reference to the whole section in the paper on the growth of database, data analysis, intelligence, surveillance? Masterful, far-sighted, nobody really quite understood it at the time, I'm sure. But certainly I didn't. I think I can give you 8 points very, very quickly. Obviously, computers are a masterful part of the entire paraphernalia of policing. They're vast data banks. Surveillance and tracking is now standard kind of activity and accepted fairly widely in CCTV. Crime mapping, used by the Nazis in Amsterdam to chart the location and homes of Jews, is now in general use in North America. You can find where your local sex offender lives and what sort of sex offense he prefers or she prefers. We know where shots are fired. We have 8 or 10 different modes of policing high crime areas in Boston. This was all there. The idea of intelligence and crime-related data being gathered, harvested, and so on is on the table. As Jean-Paul said in his brilliant review of the Risk Society, we don't really know what's the consequence of it. We know very well, and Stefan is here to testify to it, we know very well that the data are there and the analysis is there, but the police are incompetent in using anything. They can't even add and subtract. So it's not likely that they multiply and divide. Add and subtract, they do. It is not known how those things are used. Community policing is political policing, no question. Again, the review of the Risk Society is a diamond. High policing in colonial context is now a very important issue with reference, I'm doing work with the Garda and the PSNI in Ireland. There are scholars in Africa doing marvelous work. There's a very real aware of looking at the residue of colonial policing. The RCMP, of course, is exempt from such criticism and commentary. with all due respect, as we always say, with all due respect, watch for what comes next. Thirdly, some complexities remain in the reception of the work on high policing to this date. The concept has not been fully accepted as Jean-Paul might have hoped. But in his wisdom and his patience, he would have said, we will see, Peter, we will see. Or he will say, Peter, we will see, which is his style. I love that always. If he called me on the phone, say, Peter, always. It was always wonderful to hear from him. I think that most scholars continue, unfortunately, particularly the ambitious ones, to use the idea that crime focus, crime arrest, and reduction of crime, the official dream work of the police, is the primary function and obligation of scholars to document and elevate as the accomplishment of police. Without knowing two obvious points, police are tertiary at best, and secondly, they make up the stuff. We could call it MSU, make stuff up, or there are alternative uses for that S. All right, so most of them are still focused on that, unfortunately. The idea has not really been taken on board as it might have been, and it's a pity. There are still people talking about efficient and effective policing, as if the Home Office dictated the terms of democratic policing, and it's a systematic error. Very few people eschew the fact that policing is not about crime all the time, and Jean-Paul shows it in his book extremely well. Thirdly, the idea of scandal and accountability is still caught up in the rotten apples, the individuals, the self-serving notion. There's no sense in which, And the Morris Commission in Ireland is a beautiful example of the same thing again. And as long as national security pervades the definition of the phenomena, we'll never be able to penetrate it. Fourth, it seemed to me that we still know very little about secret policing. Jean-Paul was perhaps best positioned of his generation to do an analysis of the nature of secrecy in a democratic society. There's no one who's followed that. There's no one in a similar position. If we look at the 9/11 Commission, it's done by a historian who is bought and sold by the RAND, by the Justice Department, and simply put together again, it's a whole, really a series of bureaucratic problems. We know almost nothing about the Canadian intelligence system, the CIA, the FBI, the MI5, the MI6, the security functions of London Metropolitan Police, PSNI, the Guard, and so on and so on and so on. There's simply no evidence of how these organizations work. And we have no one on the inside. There are a few bits from Mr. Andreas Glaser, quite marvelous, but he's using the records of the Stasi. There is no systematic discovery, understanding of the workings of these. Now, if you think about your B minus students as the crime analysts in the CIA and the RCMP and so on, you will have an imagery of what we might expect is going on there, the B minus students. Perhaps that's a godsend, if God were here. Now, I wish that Jean-Paul were here, because he was the most masterful, capable person of summarizing and drawing together all of the bits and pieces that were dealt on the table over the course of a day or 2 days or 3 days. He would always bring them with a certain kindness and integrity that was probably lacking in the presentation. So I miss him very much. I'm very happy to be here, and it's a very sad moment in my life to actually give this paper. Thank you.